Hey, Murph. Hey, Murph, it's about 11 o'clock in the morning. You out of bed yet? Come on, buddy. Come on, Murph, come on.
Don't this won't hurt a bit.
Don't usually answer the door that quickly.
Hey, buddy.
Hello, Pete. How you going?
Good, mate.
Good. Here for a bit of a chat.
Bit of a chat? Let's go. Okay, my name's Peter Jeffrey Brock, and I've got absolutely no idea where this interview is going to go. No idea at all. It probably sends a bit of a shiver down this bloke's spine that I'm about to talk to, because he thinks, oh God, he could say anything. Could go.
It doesn't really, Pete, because I know you pretty well.
So yeah, but you also know there's a level of unpredictability about the whole thing. So we've sort of come into Greg Murphy's home. And, of course, you can look around at the decor and think, where is this guy coming from? First of all, we look at the suburb he lives in, I suppose, and you drive down this little leafy little lanes and what have you, and you park your car in a nice spot, and you walk around and you think, is this the same Greg Murphy that we know? Is there some deep meaning to the whole business?
It's temporary.
Temporary.
It's temporary, remember. It's just
anyway, temporary. The bottom line of all this is that a bit of a sort of unplugged approach. We'll go to a few areas that maybe we shouldn't go. We'll go to a few areas we should go. But it probably will contain chat that you won't necessarily find out there in the normal retail market. It won't be necessarily politically correct. So that's why it's very appropriate to
you're
talk
talking to
a very politically incorrect human being, one Greg Murphy, yes. How's it going, Murph?
Yeah, good, Pete. Yeah, I was sort of listening to you there thinking, yeah, people, the fans get plenty of politically incorrect stuff from me most of the time, but this should be reasonably entertaining, shouldn't it?
Well, it sort of sets you apart from a lot of the other guys. I mean, I the last thing I want to do is to sort of, you know, chat you up and tell you how terrific it all is, but you know, well, then again, one must cop an accolade where one can get one in life. They don't come along all that often. But if you think about it, there's a lot of political correctness in the world today.
Yeah,
you don't seem to actually get involved in too much of that.
Well, I don't know. I don't want to be a false person. You know, what you see is what you get. You see so much these days of people saying what other people want to hear. You know, it's all about what they think everyone wants to hear. So that's the line they toe. And, you know, that annoys the crap out of me, really.
It must drive you crazy when you hear someone saying things like, well, of course, you know, we put in all that effort and the boys have been working so hard. And blah, and you think, yeah, well, anyone can say that. Why don't you give us the real story?
That is so true. It is so true. I mean, you always thank the team for doing it. But the amount of stuff that we say, which is just so clearly obvious, or people say, which is so clearly obvious, you sit there and go, well, of course you're going to put in the effort. Why else would you be there? You know, we always put in the effort. Everyone puts in the effort. So to say, oh, you know, the boys have, you know, they've worked really hard and they've put a lot of effort in, and I've used that plenty of times. At the end of the day,
I bet you kick yourself after.
Yeah, you do. And you go, you're a fool.
What am I saying? Yeah. I'm a clone.
I'm falling into the same category, you know. Yeah. And but there's other stuff, you know. I've been kept the media fairly happy over the years for saying the odd thing, which has generated a bit of abuse both ways, and you know, they love it. They absolutely love it. But then they'll find it any time they can to put the knife back into you, and possibly. But they go at the time, oh, you know, that was fantastic. You say what you think, blah blah, and then they come back and try and fry about it as well. They want both sides. They want to use it because it's really good,
yeah.
And then they want to get the other side that attacks you for saying it as well. And you find that a bit confusing and a bit off sometimes. But
yeah, but you know, there's an old saying that there's no such thing as bad publicity.
Yeah, so they tell me.
Yeah, and look, ultimately, you know, you can easily be a person that's sort of innocuous, invisible type of person that sort of doesn't say too much, and I think, oh no, I don't really want to offer an opinion on that. Is there anything you wouldn't offer an opinion on?
I can't help myself.
What about politics? What about if you were over there and you're talking about Helen Clark or something? Yeah. Would you stick your two bobs with him?
Yeah, probably. I have been asked the question. Usually media are always give us a call about all sorts of stuff, and I think the politics are coming to it. But unfortunately, unfortunately, don't follow a lot of it because, again, you know, politics seem to be such a falsification of, you know, everyday life. I mean, they never seem to be worried about the things that are most important.
And they're always arguing into each other, aren't they?
Yeah, but it's childish behaviour, yeah. Which some would say we sometimes act childishly as well. But it's childish behaviour, and it's never, you know, the things that are most important, what we're actually here for, don't seem to get the attention.
And the other thing about attention. If you're talking politics for a bit, if someone does something good, you'd think they'd say, look, that's actually not a bad idea.
No, but they can't do that.
Can't do it.
No, they can't agree. No. Can't agree, even though it is the best thing that's ever happened in 25 years.
But. Would you, if you talk about politics, then do you ever see, do you get involved much in motor racing? would you ever consider being involved in politics and motor racing, like saying, I think they should change the rules.
Yeah, I can see myself probably down the line when the driving side of it sort of falls past. I unfortunately can probably see myself. That's if I ever get voted to participate in that side of it, because maybe everyone will think it would be.
But you would
be
with Mans,
thing.
Wouldn't you?
Yeah, well,
you'd be a walk-up start with Mans.
You know, I don't know about that. Cams would probably, you know, have me. No, I don't think so either. But on the political side of the, you know, with V8 supercars and the Tiga and all that kind of stuff, one day I can see myself getting involved in that, just purely because the time that I've been involved in it, criticising and the things that have gone on and sometimes questioning and wondering, and that's my problem. I always get sort of into all that stuff too much
You think it's too much? I don't know about that.
Yeah, I don't know. It drives me nuts. You know, the decisions that are made about the category that we're in and decisions that are made that affect me because I'm driving one of the race cars, yeah. and the concerns and the time spent on certain parts of the business that I think are ridiculous, they should be focused on other stuff. You know, I probably dwell on that a little bit too much, and then personally, not in any other way, but... So one day I can probably see myself getting involved in that, so I can actually, you know, have a say on it the way I think it should be done, and try and help and improve that. But that's a long way off.
I mean, right now, do you see yourself as sort of saying, Greg Murphy, get up in the morning, I just want to get in a car and just drive the wheels off it? Is that basically
bloody
your
oath.
Prime motivation?
That is it. That is it. And I mean, you probably were the pioneer in a lot of ways of changing the business from being just that, right, to becoming now this huge deal where finding a spare day to do something is unbelievably hard. I mean, shooting this has taken us how many weeks to, put together? Yeah. But the amount of stuff that's involved, it's not. And you do want to wake up one, you know, and go to the racetrack and go drive your race car or focus 100% on it. You do want to do that a lot, but you can't do that anymore. And it's because the business has got so big.
Yeah.
And the importance of sponsorship and, you know, the days of ringing up someone you knew who ran a company and going, hey, listen, Lee, how would you like to have your name on the side of my car? And they go, yeah, that sounds great. And that was the deal. Now the contracts are that thick and the obligations by the team.
Contracts drive you crazy, don't they?
They just, it's
ultimately
amazing.
It's sort of come from in there, isn't it?
Yeah.
This is a good company, they can do this, I can do that for them, let's sort of make it all happen so I can get in the car and just win races.
Yeah, but it doesn't work anymore. You know, the justification for sponsor, and you can understand that. I mean, it's a tough place and unfortunately money rules the world and you know, that's what you're always fighting against to try and, you know, give something better or give something more to someone for what they're going to give you so you're better, you know, you're doing a better job.
You've actually got to start using your own grey matter to come up with ways to suggest to them, because quite often their marketing department mightn't have thought of something. You can say, have you thought if I did this, you can exploit it
like
that?
You're always looking for a different angle to try, because we're competing against all these other teams out there for the same money. So you're always looking for a new idea, a new sponsor, someone that hasn't been involved before. And I suppose the good thing about it, though, is motorsport, has now become very mainstream, as you'd admit to, and it's very popular in Vietnam. Supercars is such a attainable sort of thing for the fans to become, so they can get so close to it, which is unique to so many other sports that you know, New Zealanders and Australians follow. You can get very close to V8 supercars. And
well, there's two things about that. Firstly, you can actually put someone in the car with you at some time, and they can actually find out for themselves the dynamics, the braking points, and you watch them. I mean, you have good fun with them, don't you? Because you put on the brakes going into a corner about 100 metres later than when you wait for their foot to bury itself on the sidewalk, you watch them. Yeah. I'll give another 100 metres here.
Absolutely.
And by that time, they're going crazy.
But the experience that they get, I mean, I've never had a person that's got out that has never gone, that was pretty cool.
Some of your vaunted All Blacks, I'll bet they've been in the car with
you. A couple. That's, well, everybody has the same reaction. And the fact of it is you cannot, and you tell people all the time, you cannot even envisage what it's like until you actually do it, because it is totally, totally different. It's a very violent atmosphere, isn't it?
Yeah, you got to taming a violent atmosphere is really the thing that a racing driver is challenged with.
It's pretty amazing, and in fact, we can do that is, I think, a pretty good thing for people to experience it, and that's pretty special.
Murph. You know,
got to have a Tonka truck, mate.
I'm got to have a Tonka truck, and every guy's got to have a shed. That's the deal.
Now, women don't understand that either, by the way.
Yes, but see, it's a secret male's business, and that's
a shed thing.
Yeah,
it is a shed thing.
Now,
you've got a big shed too.
I've got a bloody big shed. Yeah. I've a lot of people ask me, you know, when you sort of get a bit hot under the collar about stuff. And there was something that I saw recently, but no one was too sure. When you saw that Marcus Ambrose bloke, after your race had come to a halt, 2005 Bathurst, there was a bit of sort of chat. What did you actually say? Like, no one's actually watching. Just pretend.
Well, you know, Marcus got out of his car and was, Murph. I went, Marcus, he came on up, and I said, you're a friendly cowboy.
Friendly fellow.
And I said that a few times, and then he asked me about, he said, listen, I reckon the best way to go to America is Qantas. And I said, mate, no, it's not Qantas. It's not the best way. In New Zealand, Marcus. And he went, no, it's Qantas.
Did you say to him, you're a fantastic bloke?
I did. And I said, listen, I'll just tell you now that I hope you do well next year.
In
you know, because
utes.
If I miss you, you know. And he said, thanks, and turned around and walked away.
Did you happen to mention to him that you couldn't wait for him to actually go? You're that pleased for him to go, you should go now?
Well, there was something about that mentioned from a distance.
Fly off now.
That's something about me offering to pay for it. Anyway.
Murph, I've got a couple of fans' questions here. You can't actually read them because they're secret ones.
These throwaways.
Now, this is one that this will probably be best explained by the fact that lack of mechanical sympathy. We'll wait and see what you say. Please explain how you change gears without the clutch. Flat change.
Oh, well, that started when I was your teammate. Actually, I began doing it because we were doing something at the time that needed a very constant brake pressure, and I started using my left foot to do that, and realised that, hey, this isn't too bad. You can change gear without it, and I stuck with it, and basically I do it because I can have a really good constant brake pressure and control the brake pressure very easily, rather than when you're heel and toe, when you've got part of your foot on the brake pedal and you're rolling your foot onto the throttle. It varies the brake pressure a lot. So I started doing that, and I enjoy it. And you can do it. I can do it in anything that's got a crash box in it. Yeah. Otherwise, you got to use a clutch.
Dog clutch.
Yeah.
You never played a lot of other sport, did you?
No. I was pretty hopeless at everything else. Believe it or not.
Couldn't run.
No, shocking runner. Terrible. Just slow. I was just terrible. I used to hate athletics days because
you really?
I'd never won anything.
What about discus?
Actually,
stuff
no, I was
like
all right
that?
The javelin. I could throw javelin. A javelin. Yeah, okay, yeah. I think they were like the thought of that going through someone's body or something.
You're probably picturing a Russell Ingall or someone like
no,
that.
Not
maybe
that,
at the
no.
moment.
No, I was, no, back then it was probably who I was racing in carts back then who I didn't like. It was probably, yeah, anyway.
Anyway, so that side of things didn't interest you very much. But what I was getting to is that motor racing does have that unique position in that you can get people in the car with you, you can experience the dynamics. Because essentially, you're trying to sort of twist or bend the laws of physics a lot, aren't you? You've got to say,
absolutely.
Well, I know that the laws of physics say this, but I'm going to try this. And whoever does it best is the one who's going to get the most out of that car on that day. And that's means your mind can't afford to be too limited in too many areas. You've got to just do it.
Yeah, but the thing that I think people forget a lot is about motorsport, the difference is that you've got a driver who these days is a bit of an athlete because you have to be with the types of race we have. The difference between our sport, it's clearly obvious, is we've got this huge piece of machinery that dictates so much of what we do. Yeah. And, you know, gone are the days, and well, they weren't too long ago. I mean, you're looking 5, 6, 7, 8 years ago, I suppose. You know, when there wasn't so many cars that were at the front of the field, you sort of knew exactly who you're going to be up against on this given day, and you managed to drive around a few things. You know, you could drive around and still be close to the front or on the pace. Whereas these days, you know, if the thing's a couple of tenths off the pace, you're going to be, you know, you're going to struggle. Yeah. And you know, you've got that big piece of machinery that controls so much. With other sports, it comes down so much to how determined you are personally to want to achieve it. So, you know, and obviously how hard you want to work and how, you know, with tennis or football or that kind of stuff, how much effort you want to put into it. And I know there's a lot of the drivers put so much effort into it. They put everything they've got into it.
Yeah.
But that doesn't make necessarily the difference because you still have to rely on so much other stuff.
So therefore, one of the tricks, and I guess this is something that I'd like to hear your comments on, is to try and get that glue happening in your team to draw
absolutely
together all those. And you mentioned before sponsorship, and you've got to have the bucks to buy the best engines and the best
and develop and develop this and develop that and have the. But it's all about people.
Yes.
You know, it's not just about Greg Murphy getting in his super cheap car and bloody going out there and doing the job. I can't. You know. We can't do it like that. There is so much of a backbone behind us that never really gets a lot of attention, and it's exactly that. It's gluing the people together, not just one person or two people. It's not just your engineer. It's not, you know, just the team manager being a good organiser, sort
you
of type bloke.
You got that kid out there who's wheeling the tyres around the
absolutely
back, feeling like
I mean,
I'm
our,
with this
our,
team.
Our tyre guy.
Yeah.
You know, he is, you know, no one would ever think about his job, but his job isn't just bloody getting tyres mounted on rims. You know, there's the analysing of the tyre when it comes off the car. And he's one of my, he's probably my engineer's most important link, you know, really at the end of the day. I mean, the engineers, the mechanics working on the car, obviously have to get everything right there. But my engineer, his communication with our tyre guy is just so critical, and he has to, you know, work with him. But you would never think of that, you know.
Well, look,
and having all those people communicating and talking and working together and liking each other, and being able to do their jobs,
sharing the dream. I mean, they got to be there saying
it's
we
phenomenal.
Can do it. That's why a driver is an important facet. I mean, if you take a shoemaker going to Ferrari, for instance, he's going to draw to him the best engineers. Everyone's going to the extra yard because they're saying,
he has done that.
Absolutely.
Like, it's just incredible. The way he turned that team into that unbelievable mecca.
So this brings us to the way that motor racing has been viewed by, I suppose you'd call it general media and the sports editors over the years. They sort of look at motor racing saying, yeah, but it's just a battle against the manufacturers. Now, from a manufacturer point of view, they'd love to think it's like that, but unless they've got the right people and the right dynamics occurring in that team, they're not going to get a result. So I often say to some of these sports editors, look, I know it's not a stick and ball game, but you've got to understand the value of a driver. It's not just that he's got enormous skills and mind over matter, etc., but there's all these other facets.
There is. Yeah. I mean, you, it's very, you know, and we've all done it at times where the team bloody can't stand you for doing, you know, for having the crack and the shits or whatever like that, but bits and pieces. But, you know, you do have to, and it's very important, and we forget that sometimes as a driver, forget how you need to gel your team together. Yes. And make them want to work that extra hour that night to bolt something together or change
something.
What do
you do, kiss and make up? What do you do if you've done that? Because, I mean, Greg Murphy
bribery, corruption.
Fairly volatile guy. And you've got to say corruption. Things. But they can turn that into a positive, or you can turn it into a positive.
Yeah, I mean, they know. I think there's a fine line between them, between you showing, you know, being so passionate about it that you crack it. And yeah. And then there's a fine line between you just being a dickhead, you know. But I've been pretty fortunate that the teams that I've been with know who I am, and they understand that. And as long as you can say when you say that you've been a dickhead or you've acted wrongly, and you can admit it, which, you know, I think I can do that, then, you know, they understand and you move on and carry on. But, you know, you do have to work with these people and make them want to work for you. And, you know, as I say, sometimes you don't do a very good job of that. Sometimes you do a good job of that.
Do you find that you've gone through cycles there where you've gone with a team and it just hasn't worked and you know it, and inside the ego, I've got to get out of here?
Yeah, absolutely.
And people might not necessarily recognise that because they might think, hang on, they got a good sponsor and everything else.
Well, you know, last year is a prime example of that. You know, there's people who got all their own ideas on why I left the Kmart team as it was at the time and bits and pieces. And the fact of it was, you know, I had a good relationship, a great relationship with the Kellys, and you know, I had a great relationship with the guys that we had in the team, and we'd achieved some unbelievably success. Yeah, Robbie Crawford, you know, you've worked with Robbie for many, many years.
Fantastic.
He's been around for a long time. But it was just getting a bit, I think, for them with me and for me with them, it was just getting a bit stale. And, you know, I just needed a change. And they all, we all understood it. And we, you know, we're still great mates. We, you know, we pitted next to each other all year. And we've got a good relationship, and we always will have, because they know the person I was and I know, you know, them. But it was just time that I did something different, found some new ground to work with and some new people. And we both try to expand from that because, you know, they needed some new input that we hadn't had there for a while, and I needed some new challenges.
Yeah, I mean,
and that was it. You know, there was no more to it. There was, you know, I was probably getting a bit frustrated. We hadn't made the performance improvements that I wanted that year, and at the time when I decided I was going to leave, you know, there wasn't a lot on the horizon telling me what was going to be different this year. Obviously, there have been a huge lot of changes in that team, which you know, at the time I had no idea of. And no one did. You know, that happened very late.
I would say that team probably hasn't gone as well without you being there.
I think they've developed pretty good this year. I think they've been through some difficult times, and there's been a lot of changes. And just like me going to PWR, it's taken a long time for things to really start to work. We've had a lot of problems this year.
Like what?
Oh, you know, we've had mechanical failures, mainly mechanical failures. We've had five or six up to this date, you know, engine problems, drivetrain problems, all that kind of stuff, and which has affected us horrendously at important times while leading races or being, you know, Adelaide running, I think we were fifth at the time when the gearbox failed, which would have, you know, given us a lot of points. We got 0 points in that race. And then we were leading in Perth, leading a race and had an axle break. Mm. Things like that, you know, and then that weekend's destroyed because
now,
of that.
Now, when it comes to those sorts of things, you can easily get involved in finger-pointing.
Oh, yeah, it's very frustrating.
But you'd have to
sit back. You'd love to be able to blame someone.
Does it unglue things?
Yeah, but you'd love to be able to blame someone for all that kind of stuff. At the end of the day, it doesn't bloody matter in the end, you know. It's been extremely frustrating, you know, because we've had that year. And as I say, we've been in a building process just like HSV Racing's had a lot of changes, a lot of additions, a lot of things going, new driver. So they've been in a building process. So it's a year that you never want to think is going to be written off. But effectively, it is a building year to the following year. And, you know, I'm pretty impatient kind of guy, which probably not many people know.
I'm shocked to hear that.
Yeah, you're shocked. Yeah. And so therefore, you know, you don't want to have a year that's like that, but it effectively you have it. And we've had some great results this year and been pretty fast and let some slip by. And, you know, our championship, where we're sitting in the championship is totally, you know, looked so, upon like that. I mean, it's just, it's represented totally by where we are. But our speed, it's very easy for people to forget how fast you've been in some places because the results weren't there. Mm. But we've been, you know, we've had some, been looking good in a lot of races this year and then had things go wrong and therefore you look like a monkey.
Okay, Murph, another one. Ooh, have you ever scared yourself driving a race car?
I scared myself. I would say the only time I've been sort of a little bit, I don't want to say scared, I'm tough, but
yeah, you're from Hawke's Bay.
I sort of had a bit of a quiver twice. One was in New Zealand at Manfield. I was in a Formula Holden, had a brake failure down the end of the straight.
I saw that. I watched that.
Yeah, it was good.
And you just missed a tree by much, didn't you?
That's right. That's exactly right.
When was that?
1995 at Manfield, and it went through a tree. And the other time was, again, your teammate, when I was your teammate, at Phillip Island.
Oh, yeah. Cracked the front tooth. Did you do something with your mouth?
I think I did, actually. I forgot about that. I did.
Yeah,
but coming through the last
bill
corner.
Turned up at HRT.
Got a puncture, tyre failure. Well, I don't know what it was. Puncture, I think. And went off and coming out of the front straight. We're doing about, what, we're doing 220, something like that.
Quick.
Yeah. Hit the bank at about, you know, a couple hundred. And that was pretty skewed because I knew it was going to hit pretty hard because it wasn't slowing down very much. And
nowhere to go.
Nice, so those are the two times that I've been a bit, you know.
So not really when you've actually had some control over the car as such.
No.
It's always when there's cars, like you're a passenger.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, when you're not in control.
Yeah. Okay. No, I won't go to that one at the moment. Oh, here's one for you, Murph. I'll walk away while you answer it, actually. What was it like having Peter Brock as a teammate in 1997?
I'm sure that's
you
a
don't
fan.
Have to.
I'm
you
sure
don't.
That's a fan question,
you don't
Peter.
Have to.
Well, I'm sure that came from the fans. Yeah.
Well. If
well, you know
question,
what? You know what? Actually, it was a pain in the ass because you were retiring.
I know.
And you drove me mad. Oh. Is the Cameron's phone? I thought you said he turned that off.
Oh, I don't
He's
know.
He's a liar. You drove.
What happened? You pick up cheap help like that. They need to have their mobile phone in case a job offer comes
along.
Maybe
the fans should write in just to say what they reckon the quality of this film's like.
Exactly.
Yeah, that was pretty entertaining stuff, Pete. You drove every race meeting we went to.
Yeah.
We must have had 40 hours of autograph sessions, and the fact of it was no one wanted
mine. Did I make you go there?
Yeah.
Did I make you go to them?
Yeah.
I'm sorry about that.
Man. Yeah.
I shouldn't have done that to you because I was in
And then, what does he do? Comes back out of retirement.
That's over.
Yeah, good.
Good.
Mm. And you know what? Last year, you went the fastest you've ever been around Bathurst, eh?
I did.
Yeah.
I did.
It's pretty amazing.
It still wasn't bloody good enough. Anyway, mind you.
That's pretty good.
Didn't get to drive and therefore we'll never know, Murph.
Oh, that's true.
Ooh.
That's true.
Anyway, I mean, obviously the mountain is a big deal. So it's the grand final and you want to get it right. And you get it right pretty often these days. You showed some good pace up there in 2005. But, you know, it was there to be won, I thought.
Mm.
I thought you had the fastest Holden there. And you're probably every bit as fast, if not faster, than Ambrose.
Well, I think we had the pace on him. Scafie... did a very good job, and I think what they did this year was very similar, almost emulated Rick and I last year. Mm. Almost they were strong at the not as strong at the beginning. Scafie sort of struggled in the first stint a little bit. Maybe it was a tyre pressure thing or something, which is exactly what our problem was last year. By the second and third stints, they dunk to the front. Mm. And then basically controlled it from there, and it was a very strong performance. And I don't think we didn't have the pace, or we didn't have quite what he had. We were very close, but you know we had a few issues up there that really evolved during the day. Like our fuel economy was very poor up there this year.
Is that because of the Larry engine, or?
Well, it's just a development thing. Yeah, a development thing on the engine. Engines were good, but used way too much fuel, and basically we were putting ourselves in a catch-up position every time we stopped for fuel because we were three, four, five laps earlier than the other guys we're competing against. So they're on a light fuel for three or four laps, going fast, while you're on heavy fuel, going to 1 or 2 seconds slower, so you fall behind.
Plus, and you've got, if you do a sort of a splash and dash, you're going to be there 3 or 4 seconds longer.
Well, they were working on a four-stop strategy, a lot of these guys, and we right from the beginning of the day, knew we were on a five-stop because there was no way we were going to get, no way we were going to get four stops, but then it was the fuel economy was even worse than what we had worked out, you know, through the laps that we'd done throughout the weekend, throughout the few days before.
So when you've got safety cars and stuff like that, of course, that can help you out.
The last safety car for the day put us back in the game.
Yes.
That timing of that safety car was so spot on, it put us back in the game. Because up until then, we were 25-odd seconds behind the leaders and therefore out of it 100%. Still in fourth position, but out of the game. But the last safety car put us back in it. And it put Marcus back in it as well. I mean, they were out of it. They were miles back.
The debacle that was with their fireproof equipment in the car and how it became politicised like that.
Yeah.
I mean, that's really, you've had that happen to you, haven't you, at different times. And you'd have to say, what's it mean? What's it all about? How do you fix it? How do you get some common sense in it?
It's a tough one, you know. It is a tough one, and the rules, you know, we know the rules and bits and pieces. It seems petty almost, you know, some of the stuff that happens, and I'm not sure how or why, you know, they got put in the position where they had to go through the that whole balaclava scenario and all that kind of thing. But it's, you know, it wasn't just that race it caused problems for. It's now caused us problems for the rest of the, you know, for as long as we may know, with our underwear and fireproof stuff and all this kind of thing.
Now that you've got to, look, correct me if I'm wrong, but you've got a three-layer suit and you've got to wear an extra layer under it. Is that how it is?
Yeah, absolutely.
What about if you had a two-layer suit, which is legal, and one layer of underwear?
Yeah, well, we have to go through changing all
that kind
of stuff. So
that means you're going to have nude racing suits to finish up with the same number of layers?
Yep.
Now, I'd have to sit back and say that is abject stupidity.
But the other thing, Pete, is that, you know, this is all stuff that's happened that we knew about for a long time, but we've gone along our merry way for a while, and now it's been exposed maybe that certain people weren't, you know, running to the exact rule, which is a shame that it's now come to this. But you know, these rules that we're given to have to wear this stuff, right? Mm. They didn't test it down in Australia in a Holden Commodore V8 supercar
running 45 at 40 degrees C or whatever.
Exactly, and in a 30 degree ambient day in Australian heat, they didn't go, oh well, you know, you can. We'll do the test down here with one of these drivers on this underwear stuff and see what happens. They did it in England,
and in
March.
And the bloke probably did about 18 laps.
Yeah,
it was
4 degrees.
Astra.
That's right.
With power steering and everything else, and
with his aircon on, and he probably wanted to wear underwear because it was that bloody cold outside. So. You know, our things generate so much heat, as you know, and there's no insulation. They just, all the heat from the gearbox and the exhaust, which goes right underneath the car, it all soaks straight into that metal. And so the metal stays hot. And these things, you know, and this is one of the things that really annoys me is some of the decisions that are made that affect the driver directly, and no one seems to give a toss about it. No one gives a toss.
Well, you've got people that...
Have never done it.
I've got no idea how to do it. Can't put themselves into your position.
Very ignorant. Decisions.
That's always a difficult one.
Very ignorant. And I got to say, you know, now what we're going to go through is a period of spending a whole heap of dough developing and trying to find ways.
Dale Rogers will be happy.
Oh yeah, people that sell the stuff will be wrapped. But it's just very, very difficult. I haven't worn a cool suit. I've never worn a cool suit. Well, I lied. Back in '97 when we were racing together, I wore one occasionally, but since then I've never worn one. And it's something now I'm going to have to look at.
Keen on them, you know.
No, well, but I'm going to have to.
But if you get it, you got to make sure it's totally reliable.
And it works, because then it doesn't work. Like Rick Kelly had won at Indy, and it failed.
That's been going on for years. I don't know how it happens. It's like 2-way radio.
So now you've got this cool suit with all this fluid in it that's getting hot, and you can't do anything about it.
So. It's like a hot water bottle.
That's right. So there's all that stuff that now we've got to come into. And Bathurst, was something that happened, and it's now caused a heap of grief, and away we go.
So that business created a lot of comment, that stack up in the mountain there. Mm. But you've never walked away from controversy. I mean, it's just been Greg.
Bathurst has been some of the biggest,
hasn't it? Movie.
Yeah.
And, you know, that was a classic, wasn't it? Well,
the only thing was there was no Portaloo to go and smack at the time.
Exactly.
Yeah, 2002. Yeah.
Lazy
5 minutes in the loop. But, you know, the whole thing's pretty dismal. I was pretty angry with myself in the respect that I allowed Marcus to get into a position where then an accident was happening. You know, I went into Griffin's Bend trying to get past the WPS car that was in front of us, and subsequently ran a bit wide. Well, it ran quite wide on the exit, and
couldn't get on the gas.
I was got on the gas a bit too late. Yeah, that's right. And then Marcus got up alongside and pulled the nose ahead, and that's where we sort of equalised. Mm. And I remember thinking at the time, right, we'll get through here because we'll run round there together. And then we'll argue it when we get to the cutting. Mm. Because it's a slower corner and we'll see what happens there. And we're running up the hill, and then he comes across the front because he went to take his apex.
The classic line.
Went to take the racing line because he was on the racing line and I was narrow. And when he came across to take his line, that's when I knew it was all over because there was no way. He came across quite aggressively to take the line, and obviously he had hoped or thought or assumed, I'm not sure, that I was going to back out.
Yeah.
And I never had any intentions of backing out because I had already planned what I was going to do. Now, see, this is the thing, you know, everyone's got their opinions, everyone wants to be an expert, everybody, you know, the Ford fans are this and the Holden fans are that, and that's what's great about what we do, because the fans are what make our sport.
The great thing about all that is that the consequences are so high. Mm. See, if it's a bit of El Biffo in a rugby game or something, it can be...
You carry on.
Or something like that.
Yeah, you carry on.
You get a bit of blood rule comes in or something. But, you know, here we are with a massive amount of carnage out there,
but
really.
That's right.
The race is sort of like the whole face of it is changed forever because... now you've got to wait for 2006.
That's right, yeah. And it's the biggest race of the year. And that's why this was such a big deal, because it's Bathurst. If it happened somewhere else, look at Eastern Creek, you know, when Marcus and Scafie, buddy, you know, it was like, oh, blah, 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 and away it was gone. But this was Bathurst. You know, and people come up to me, I had people come up, you know, Ford fans, going, why'd you take him out? And you sit there and you go, I'll ask you a question. Why the hell would I take him out in Bathurst with 20 laps to go when I'm running fourth and know I'm going to get on the podium? And they sort of go, oh, yeah, well, yeah, but anyway, you crashed into him. It's like, you know, and that's fine. I've got no problem with that. And as I say, that's what it's all about, having the fans and that. But, you know, you have rocks in your head to think that at 180 kilometres an hour,
you're gonna
with 20 laps to go, you're going to launch someone into a fence and one of the most... You know, on a track where when you have an accident, you hit something hard.
Well, look, I think one of the things that I don't know if this has been explained very clearly to anyone out there that doesn't race or isn't involved with it in a very close manner. But and you that, know, there's that, only that is, one line through that corner.
Yep, absolutely. You know, like and otherwise you've got to actually slow down. You've got to manoeuvre appropriately. You can't go through there to
once
abreast
like
if you,
that,
if you
say,
think you're going to.
And I've seen plenty of stacks on that corner through the same sort of thing.
Yeah.
But I've also seen an enormous amount more avoided because the guy on the outside's going, look, I'm not too sure about this. And I reckon I can still get into that cutting pretty good.
I mean, the arguments, arguments were going through. I mean, the fact of it is, I could have pulled out of it.
Yeah.
Right? Two, he could have pulled out of it. Or three, we both had the same thought and we went around the corner together. Now, it didn't happen. We had a big blue about it. Marcus chose what he was going to do. I chose what I'm going to do. Now, who's right, who's wrong? Well, we'll never agree. The fans will have their opinion forever, and that's good, right? I accept that the steward said, listen, you're both to blame, and that's it, no problem. But the fact of it is, the only two people that actually really know what was going on was the guy sitting in car 51 and the guy sitting in car 1. And apart from that, you know, everyone else can have their views on it, but it's a mental game, isn't it?
The whole thing of driving,
and it's extremely disappointing. And the letdown when that happens at that point, the letdown for me, for him, for the team, is just massive, devastating.
Massive.
And it's you know, it's a lot bigger than just all the media stuff. It's a lot bigger than that for me, and it's a lot bigger than that, I'm sure, for Marcus. And we don't get on. We never have really, but. You know, I respect him as a race driver because you can't not respect someone who's won 2 championships. The way he goes about his other stuff, you know, we won't see eye to eye on that on certain things. But, you know, the thing happened. It was disastrous for both. We were going to be on the podium. There's no doubt about that.
Okay, so. If you just sort of fast forward to 2006 and the same thing was going to happen again, I think
both people would look at it differently. They're both drivers would go, "Hey, that happened 12 months ago. Well, let's you know, I don't know." But it's a tough question because I made a decision at the time to do something. I suppose if you're in that position again, it's going to be in the back of your head, isn't it? So it depends who's going to actually think about it first and back off. I don't know. But you don't want that.
When you're a racer, you want to do it.
I mean, at the end of the day, would the team be? What would the team say if you were going, oh no, you go, you know? Would they have been, okay, if I'd pulled out of it, we both would have got around the corner, but then I would have been back a spot.
Okay, now Murph, backyard. I notice you got very, very clearly defined borders on this lawn. Is that how your mind works?
Clearly defined borders.
Have you got a mind that's sort of like...
It's brilliant.
It's good, isn't it?
No, mate, we didn't have anything to do with this place.
Okay, what at the little meditation centre here, mate?
Yeah, meditation centre. This is where Monique sends me when I'm a bad boy.
Yeah, which is often.
Which is bloody often.
And you got the blackboard in there for...
It's our strategy. Ronan and I come and do our strategies in here on, you know, on pit stops and that kind of thing.
Noughts and crosses.
Yep.
Anything like that?
Yeah, you can see it's well maintained.
It's just one of those ones where you close the door, out of sight, out of mind.
Yeah, and then it doesn't stay closed. We're building, well, we haven't started yet, but so this is our temporary home at the moment. And this is my very temporary shed.
Imagine building a place, Murph.
Oh, mate, it's going to
be... You'll love it.
Yeah, it's going to drive us both nuts, I think.
Oh, gee, we've got some goodies in here, haven't we now?
Isn't it a mess?
Oh, look at this large object here. What's this thing here? Some sort of brush cutter.
Heli chopper.
Oh, a helicopter.
Yeah, mate, you like that? Look at that. Bit of a radio control freak.
I mean, would you... Why haven't you had a real full-size one? It's almost full-size.
Well, I'm learning to fly, eh? The last couple of weeks, I've spent quite a bit of time learning to fly. I'm about 15 hours away from getting my licence.
Trans-Tasman flights coming?
No, I don't think so, but I love helicopters. Helicopters and aviation and cars are my passions.
You're not a fixed-wing type person?
Yeah, well, we got one up here. Oh, yeah. Here we go. Is the fixed-wing version.
Model or is that
no, I actually haven't flown that yet, but it's brand new. It's brand new. There's the wing for it. She's a fairly big old girl.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I'm...
Where do you fly them? Where do you do it?
Oh, you need a pretty big area, a proper RC sort of area for flying that. I mean, I can fly that down the park, the chopper.
What is this chopper? I mean, do you have a cranker up at the backyard or something like
that? Yeah, it's been cranked up in the backyard.
Is it illegal or not?
I don't think so. It's pretty dangerous.
Make sure
the kids aren't around. Oh, it's, yeah, a little bit. Makes a bit of noise. It's a good thing.
Dangerous? Can you imagine that?
You'd never want to be near this. These would tear you apart.
Yeah, bit of skill in flying.
So the shed's a bit small for everything.
What's this for?
Oh, hanging the bike up when I'm doing work on it. So
you got a few bikes, haven't you?
Yeah, I love my mountain biking and cycling.
I've really gotten into that myself. Yeah. Good thing to do.
And the golf clubs.
And you got the little crackers here.
Yeah, Roni's madman on the bike.
He'd love that.
Well, this one's a bit big for him actually. He's bloody, he's got his, he's been tearing around without outriggers now for a couple of months, and he's but this one's just a bit
big. So
he's
about to get rid of this sort of inner
layer. Yeah, it's gone. That was Cormac's. He's moved on. Going to the next stage.
Big moment. Golf.
Next stage. Yep.
What's happening with golf?
I like, do you play golf?
A little bit. Never.
I like golf. I'm a big fan.
I can never do it good enough to sort of.
Yeah, it's a. Yeah, I know. But I really enjoy it. It's a challenge. Another bloody challenge, all right?
So, are you a collector at all?
I collect stuff. I'm a shocker.
So you don't really turf it out?
No.
What about all your old trophies and stuff?
I sort of let myself down there a little bit. You know, the race teams these days are pretty keen on keeping the trophies. Yeah. They spend the money, so they think they should probably keep the trophies, which is fairly fair. So, I got some Bathurst trophies at home, but at the workshop, keep them all at home. At the office, I should say. So they're all there.
Look, it's one of those things, Murph, where at the time you don't think much about it, but later on you think, ooh.
I know, I exactly right.
A charity auction item or a museum piece.
Yeah, I do a lot. I mean, we get phone calls all the time for people wanting signed memorabilia or merchandise and that kind of thing. So, yes. You spend a bit of money a year on that, which is all good. Yeah, I quite enjoy doing it. But you've also got all your, at the end of the year, your team gear, where some guys like to go and sell it or whatever. We'll auction stuff and or give it away to charities to auction off, and they always get good money for it.
Concentrate mainly on Hawke's Bay type area, or
no, all in New Zealand, but here Australia as well. I'm a patron for Camp Quality.
Yep,
and it's a charity that I feel pretty strong about. So, we help them out as much as we can, but it's hard to say no to.
Do you think
to people
we'd see a Greg Murphy Museum in the future? We might, mightn't we? So therefore, you could say. Is that a bit of a cot up there?
Yeah, all this stuff,
you can see it there. This is a dresser, Greg Murphy shaved in that
shocker.
Dresser, cut himself a few times, got the sideburns just so.
I know. I have got a lot of stuff that I'm a bit like, I started thinking about it not that long ago, thinking about, that poster, it could be a good thing to have in 10 years or 15 years and stuff. So I have got a bit of stuff lying around the place.
Let's cut to another way of looking at racing cars, and I've had involvement with a lot of other sports nowadays, and one of the great things that motor racing has is the need to have a very strong mind. It's sort of it's called in when people talk about training your mind, like mastery of the mind. Stops your mind inventing things, or because you're working on that's what I'm doing, and I'm focusing on that bit of road, and I'm getting this car down that bit of road. And the rest of the world can do what the rest of the world's sort of doing. I mean, this other stuff's happening around you, but you really are determined to do what you are doing. If you don't do that, you sort of just don't quite get there. You're a damn good operator, but you're not actually going to be able to get those results that the team respect you for.
Yep.
So there's a fine line, isn't it?
I mean, you look at, and it got sort of forgotten because of other things that happened on that day, but you look at Lounsey,
right? Driver error.
Now he didn't. I don't know what exactly happened there, but there's a guy that's had the fastest car on the day, right? Walson around, and I don't really think he was probably pushing overly hard, because we know what he's like and how he was probably doing it fairly easy. Car was good, driving it on a pretty, on a high limit, but probably not the highest that he could have been, because he was controlling
it all. Could agree more, yeah.
And next minute, things in the fence, I mean, just like that, it changes so quickly. Now he's got a very high level of, the way he looks at his success and that kind of thing.
He doesn't show it sometimes.
He always puts on a smile.
He's a perfectionist.
Yeah, and he always puts on a smile, but he would have been absolutely gutted.
Yeah. Yeah.
And, for something like that to happen,
simple
for a guy who's at his level.
Loss of concentration for a moment.
What happened? Bang, hit the wall.
I mean, mind has just wandered on to.
But you can't say that he doesn't put himself. And it would have been hurting. I mean, he puts himself right up there because of the way he is.
A sponsor there that probably thought, ooh, we got ourselves a real return for our investment dollar here.
Mm.
And one small thing like that has just changed their day. No, I couldn't agree more. That's as simple lapse in concentration.
Yeah, bloody oath.
Because when you're in the zone, as you know, you don't do things like that. It's just like you might miss a wall by that much every lap.
That's right. Yeah.
So get in and out of it. What causes that? Physical discomfort?
Sure, some just other something, issue just in mind. Something just comes into your head for that split second.
So mastery of the mind is a very important aspect to car racing. And in fact, I'd have to say that probably that is the factor that says, I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
A lot of good drivers out there, but it's interesting how some of them will never, ever be at that level.
And you nailed it, that it comes down to what they're actually wanting to achieve. And it's, you know, I think there's plenty out there in car racing land and V8 land at the moment that love the whole thought of this, hey, what do? I'm a V8 supercar driver, you know, and that's what they get the kick out of. And they'd like to think it's the winning, but I think it's also the life of a lot. That's the so-called lifestyle, which seems to be such a glamorous thing. But you know, for a lot of us, the amount of effort and work that goes into it, it's not so glamorous. I mean, the time you spend away. I mean, you travel like nothing else. I travel, you know, around the countryside, New Zealand, backwards and forwards every couple of weeks.
Yeah.
And the family suffers big time. Yeah. And so that's the dedication, I suppose, that you're prepared to do that kind of thing and do everything you possibly can, whereas I think there's a lot of guys out there that just enjoy the
sitting on the line. You want to be there as numero uno. That's it.
Absolutely.
You're saying, that's it. I won't
be satisfied if my driving days in, you know, finish and I haven't won this championship. I will be purely gutted.
Yeah.
You know? And there'll have to come a time where it doesn't matter how much longer you think you can go, you're not going to win the championship, you know. So
a lot of guys that see themselves as being pretty good if they sort of get, you know, top 15. And, you know, guess what?
If you're satisfied with that, well, then, you know, that's your choice.
And, you know, when you hire someone to drive your car, you've really got to look at that aspect, because if a person's satisfied in life, that's what they want to be.
It's the wrong person.
You can do all the eye-hand coordination skills stuff.
It still costs the same amount of money to have someone in a car to run a car for someone that wants to do that than what it costs to run a guy that wants to be at the front of the field.
A few softs out there.
A few softs?
Softs. Sons of rich fathers.
Oh, there we go. Yeah, Pete, I'm impressed. That's very good. It's very good. Well, there always will be. Yeah. I mean, and that's motorsport, isn't it? That's a sport where, you know, where the equipment costs more than a tennis racket or a set of golf clubs and stuff. There's always going to be that element in there. But you know, there's some guys in there that have proven that that they can do the job, even though they are, you know, they have had it for them all the way through.
But a lot of those parents have also said, well, I'm not going to exactly hand it to them on a plate. They're going to have to work for it.
Yeah, and some do that. But there's others that have just handed them to them on a plate.
And they don't necessarily deliver the goods.
No, that's right.
So where I'm headed with this question, and you probably didn't know where I was headed. But where I'm going.
Do you want me to abuse someone or something?
No. Oh, okay. No, I'm thinking Greg Murphy, go-karts, stuff like that. I mean, you got out there and got stuck into it as a kid.
Yeah.
And obviously you had to sort of make it work for yourself. I mean, you had your dad there who was helping out, and your mama who was helping out and what have you, and a, you know, good support group around you, but it wasn't as if you sort of had the...
No, I think that you learn to appreciate so much, not just with the sport, but you, you know, as a person, it makes you really understand how hard and what it's all about and appreciate stuff a lot more, doesn't it? Yeah. Not just in your car racing, but...
Well, you've got to dig deep, haven't you? Like, you've got to say, I'm going to do, you know, I've got to feel it.
And you know, when I was growing up, we didn't have it coming out our ears, and my parents sort of they split up when I was pretty young, and so Dad and I used to, and my sister, although she sort of soon realised it was becoming Dad and I, and so she wanted probably stayed at home with Mum more often, but, you know, we got into the karting thing, and it was a great way for him and I to spend time together. On the weekends, basically, and that became a huge part of our life. Karting became, every weekend. I suppose that's probably sent me off in the direction where the cricket in summer and the rugby in winter got left behind, because we were away every other weekend around the countryside racing karts, or at our local track in Hawke's Bay doing it. So all the other bits and pieces I sort of started falling by the wayside and concentrating on karting. And we used to put everything we had, or and every spare bit of time into you know, working on karts and getting as good as we could with what we had.
Now, that's an interesting point you raise there, because if we assume that someone somewhere on this planet's ever going to see this interview occur,
well, if they watch half it, they'll probably throw it in the bin.
They probably will. But the point is that most people think that race drivers are born with perhaps a silver spoon in their mouth, so to speak. That was all handed to them.
It's probably fairly easy to have that assumption.
It would, because it's an expensive sport. But and when you talk to school kids, particularly from a mentoring point of view, which we'll get to a bit later, but I was sort of figuring that it'd be good if people could understand that you get there through total commitment, application, passion, all those things. And well, what motivated you?
Initially the motivation was based around just seeing, you know, watching these carts with people driving around, and just the whole thought of being able to do that. And because we used to go to the racetracks, you know, watch the racing cars. We don't have a background in it. My dad didn't have a background, you know. There was no relationship with family down the line. So we used to go to the car racing and watch the cars, and I just loved car racing. Just loved watching the cars going round and round and following these guys in these fantastic looking machines. And then we started karting, and just the thought of me being able to be in control, I think it was a control thing, in control of something, and racing at speed and the adrenaline, the whole thing, that's where it all started. And then we got into this thing a bit more serious, and you know, I had a competitive nature. And once you start to build on that, and you start, I've got to beat that kid up there. And we always had sort of second rate equipment. It became more of a challenge, you know, to beat these kids. The satisfaction of achieving something when you know you didn't have.
So how did you overcome that? Because this is a good point. How did you overcome the fact that, because a lot of kids will say, if you give me that car and those tyres, I'll win. But if you can't afford it and you still want to win, there's got to be that X factor there. What made you do that?
I think it was just the fact that we had to find other ways to achieve it. You know, there was.
Did you cheat?
No, we didn't cheat.
I mean, did you let their tyres down or something?
No, we didn't. It was good. I never thought of that. We never had that sort of bone in our body, I think, but maybe we could have. There's my phone. That might be the wife. You want to check that there, Si. So we had to find other ways to achieve the goals, you know, and we couldn't do it by spending all the money. So that we had to just be a bit more smarter about it, I suppose. Yeah. And
but as a person, though, you must have felt like, you know, I've got this stuff inside.
I never really you know, got upset about that, or never. We just carried on.
What made Greg Murphy say
that? I think I thought I was quite lucky. I think I thought everything that I got that we bought, or you know, we got a set of tyres. You know, Dad and I'd go and work a weekend in an orchard, picking apples in Hawke's Bay, so we could afford to buy a new set of tyres. You know, and we used to do that quite a lot. We used to, you know, go through hell or high water, do whatever we could, and getting a new set of tyres was like holy crap, because we used to buy everyone secondhand ones. You know, so that's what we did. And I don't think I ever thought that I was hard done by.
No.
We just knew that was the case, and everything I got, like I borrowed $1,000. This was, you know, it was quite a long time ago, but I borrowed $1,000 at that time. $1,000 was like, oh my God, I didn't even know what that looked like.
Yeah.
From my grandmother, right, to buy a cart, which was a secondhand one, but it was the bee's knees.
Was it a Hillman Hunter or something?
It was actually, what was it called? No, it was a cart.
Okay. I just wondered if it was a paddock bomb.
I can't remember, it was a cool thing. Yeah. Well, that comes later. That all came later.
Yeah.
But so I bought this cart. It was the best thing, and just loved it. And you know, it was the best cart I'd ever had. And you know, I paid her back weekly. I was like, whatever I could. I had like four jobs that I was doing, and so every week I'd put money into a little envelope and under my bed, and give it to her when she came to visit. But you know, it was a challenge. I don't know. I never really thought it was a negative. I you learn to appreciate. So everything we got from there, and we, you know, worked very hard, and then people start to go, oh, he goes pretty good. And then, so then we'd have the local car dealer, he'd give us a hand with parts, and then he talked to the cart manufacturer, who then said, okay, we'll give you a chassis, and then it just started to go, and you work really hard for that, because you've achieved that, and someone's given you something, you want to give something back to them. Yeah. And so you go that extra mile. And
so what about this business of translating that into like mentoring, in a sense? You got kids or race fans who come up to you. I mean, it's a good story. It's a good message.
It is, but you don't want to tell them something to make them feel good about it. They say, what do I need to do? What does little Johnny need to do? I say, well, the fact of it is, it's not easy, you know. And the first thing I say is how determined and how passionate are you about it? Because that's a hard thing to interpret when someone asks you that question, because you don't know how. You think you're determined, you think you're passionate, but you need a few tests along the way to find out exactly if how much you are or how much you aren't, and if someone else has got a little bit more.
I'm always reminded of Karate Kid, wax on, wax off stuff. You know, like you go through.
I think I've got
life
that on DVD.
And
actually,
you're doing it and doing it and doing it and doing it. Why am I doing this? Well, you mightn't understand why you're doing it, but you're actually conditioning yourself.
Little did we know that movie meant so much more.
But here you are, you know, later on now, and you've actually taken on all those lessons in life and that way of thinking, and it's paying dividends.
Yeah.
And you're quite correct, I guess. There's no easy way of doing it, because you can't just take a pill and get to be a fast driver.
No.
It's like, no. Mm. You've got to go through all this stuff. Be like a blues singer, isn't it? You've got to go to hell and back. You've got to do it. You've got to feel it. You've got to actually experience it. And then you get good at it.
Yeah.
Because you've got all those different facets. Who is your hardest rival in a racing sense? Oops.
Well, that's a really difficult question, because I don't think there's one person.
Yeah,
you know?
It's not really a good question, is it, in that sense?
It's tough, because, you know, there's a lot of guys out there that...
Varies.
That are very difficult.
One day some bloke's on, it's their turn, and all of a sudden, hey... But
there's probably blokes I enjoy racing against more, maybe. Because,
who won't launch you?
Well, you just know that it's going to be a really good fair battle. And I think Lounsey's one of those guys.
Yeah.
You know that you're going to have a good... And there'll be never anything... I never think that there's going to be anything intentional by anyone, because I don't think that anyone does anything really that's ever intentional, other than the odd, you know, little tap. But, everyone's hard. They're just hard. I mean, Scafie's very hard, and you know he's always giving 110% when he's chasing you. Or when you're behind him. Lounsey, him, Garth's real tough. The list is long. I mean,
what about Ingle?
Russ and I have had some great races. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we've had some good blues as well. But you know, he's definitely fast, and you know, you've got to have your wits about you when he's around.
Tell you, there'll be one name that people keep on asking about is where will he go? What can he do? Is young Rick Kelly? How's he go?
Well, I reckon Rick had done anything he wanted to. You know, I've obviously been fairly complimentary of him over the last little while, but the fact of it is, I totally rate his ability. For a guy that age,
could do anything.
He could have done it. He could have. I think he'll be here for a very long time. And you know, he's cemented himself as being one of the top blokes in V8s in Australia.
What about Ambrose? Next question.
I said before. You know, Marcus is very fast.
Would he have to, you know, put him in there sort of like on his day? Like, this guy can do the job. I mean, his record speaks.
He can do the job. I mean, the thing is, he's been in one team only.
Yeah.
And he's been in a team that has been brilliant.
Yes.
And so the question is, you know, what would happen being somewhere else, you know? But that hasn't been shown. I think, you know, going off to America, that's a pretty bold move.
Yeah.
But you've won two championships here, you might as well give it a go, I suppose. It's going to be tough. I think he'll be back.
So Stone Brothers, you'd say, have done a pretty good job. Stone and Brothers, any driver gets with them is going to be automatically elevated anyway.
Yep, absolutely.
Good approach. If you just briefly on that for a moment, they're racers, aren't they? They just want to race cars.
You've got to understand that they own the team. They are the team. They have been in the game for a long, long time.
Yeah.
They're not in the game for anything other than racing and winning. Yeah. Now that's quite different to a lot of other businesses that run race cars. You know, they don't take money out of it. They take what they can, what they need to survive and live, and every other cent goes into their car.
You talk to them and their family and their wives do the washing.
They
run the barbecues and stuff.
Dye runs their merchandising side of stuff. Yeah. You know, it's a pretty impressive setup.
You'd have to say there's a bit of a lesson there somewhere, wouldn't you? You know, when you focus, when you have that passion, that's what you're doing.
It's a big lesson.
The results are there.
Yeah.
Okay, here's one that, I don't know, this could be the shortest answer you ever gave me, Murph, or it could be the longest one. Will you stay with Holden? There is Ford an option.
Yes and no.
Yeah, okay, that's it.
Hopefully the people heard those questions in the right order.
Exactly.
Otherwise those two answers I gave you are pretty... Yeah. I mean, the explanation is, you know, I've sort of toyed with the odd offer to go, and I've looked at the scenarios and bits and pieces. At the end of the day, for myself, my personal point of view on it, if I went and shifted now after all the effort and the work and the time and the... that I've put into being a Holden driver.
Crazy.
It'd almost be crazy.
Look, Murph, I've spent a bit of time in New Zealand, your native country.
And New Zealand specifically,
I suppose. Look, you're a Holden face there, and it just makes sense, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. So there is something called credibility in this world. Do you think you got much?
I think I've got a lot of loyalty. I think I've got credibility, yeah.
And if I may just finish off by
loyalty takes you down some funny roads, but...
It does, but I think it always gives you the ultimate reward.
Yeah.
And if you're a person who wears your heart on their sleeve, as it were, and you sort of can't help but say, that's how I feel, that's what I'm doing about it, ultimately people respect that.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. So it must be difficult for you, I suppose, juggling the life now of PR and running around and racing cars and having a family life.
Yeah, listen, you know, it is. And, you know, you ask my wife, which she won't because she won't come near a camera, but, you know, you can ask her about that kind of thing and how much I sometimes bitch and moan about it all. You know, because you get tired, you just get tired. And I think that's more what it is. You just get tired and you go, oh, God, I've got to go into something else. But... I said the thing I said to her the other day, and I said to someone else the other day, we were talking about the amount of stuff that you have to do, and sometimes, you know, you think, oh, I've had enough, I don't want to know about it, but you keep doing it, you know. So deep down, you might like to think that you don't enjoy it.
Greg Murphy,
but you
driven.
But you do. You know, there's a lot of stuff, and you get to have a lot of good times, you know, a lot of things you do. I don't know about you, but I find it ridiculous sometimes that the way people perceive, you know, there's Peter Brock, there's Greg Murphy, oh, I've got to have his autograph, oh, you're a legend. You go, there's no way on earth I'm a bloody legend. You know, it just doesn't...
Have you ever been called...
You know, it's funny.
Have you ever been called Greg Perfect or something like that?
Oh, no, not...
Can you imagine what that's like?
That doesn't sound
because
right.
Because you can simply go, no.
I think we'll leave that at Peter, but it's... you know, it's wonderful, it's fantastic, but I don't do it for that. But I still find it funny that you know. But that's what it. I don't know how you explain all that stuff. I don't know how you explain why people see you as being something.
It doesn't relate to me. I don't think I could do that to someone. You know, if I saw someone come up there. Eric Clapton or something like that, you know, and said, I wouldn't, I don't know.
Yeah, but it's, okay, that, you just got to accept that's what it's all about.
They're fantastic what they do.
And it is fantastic, and you love it, but, you know, you just go, you know, people, you know, I'm doing it because I love doing it. You don't have to, you know, you don't have to put me on some pedestal because of it, but it makes you feel fantastic. And I'm not going to make you try and give you a big hit on this one. But one thing that absolutely stands in my mind still to this day, and you'll probably say I remember, but I know you would. There's no way you could.
Well, I pretend I remember.
Is it? Yeah. You were driving one of those bloody horrible, at the time, those little, which I thought you'd never ever do. You just nearly destroyed me when you did it, being that my cart number was 05 and I had a Brock t-shirt, which you never charged us for, by the way, either. That was fantastic. We mail order through one of the magazines back in 86 or something, right? I pulled out this page, this mail order thing out of a magazine that was the Peter Brock mobile, you know, merchandise, and I had to have the stuff, and my dad got it for me, sent through a. I must have, back then, did we have credit cards back then? I can't remember. Anyway, you never charged us for it, so thanks for that.
Damn.
Probably want your royalties now. And anyway, back down in Wellington. It was, what year was when you were there in the Beamer?
Beamers. 88.
88?
Yeah.
So we're there, down there, my mate and I, first time we've been to Wellington Street Race. My old man had been going down there since it began for a few years and never took me along. So we're down there, me and my mate, were walking around.
It was a great
around.
Atmosphere, wasn't it?
Oh, it was fantastic. Out on the wharf, you know, all the cars were in the big sheds. And we're walking around there and, here's Peter Brock's cars. You know, we're a bit disappointed they were BMWs.
I was a bit too.
Just a tad. And we're walking along, we're standing there for ages just looking. And there, you knew we were wandering around. And you came over and we said, okay, Peter. You came over, you started talking to us. And we're just like, you know, you just stand there like, it's Peter Brock. He's talking to us. And it was hilarious. He sort of stood and talked for about 5 minutes and wandered off and did something else. And what I'm trying to say is, I've been in that position where you get now people come up and talking to you and they're like, wow, you know, you spoke to us. And it is. It's quite surreal. And you know, I don't take it for granted that you do that or have that effect. And I don't think I ever will, because I still find it.
You like
you know,
to keep your feet on the ground.
Yeah, and like, you know, I, as I say, it's wonderful, and I love talking to the fans when you can, as much as you can, because it, you know, you've got to have all that perspective and everything, and you are doing something that people want to watch on TV, and you happen to be driving in V8 supercars, which is
but
the biggest.
But you're still a human being.
Huh?
You're still a human being. Yeah, after
absolutely,
all.
You know, and you shouldn't be treated any differently. And that's why you should never treat anybody else any differently.
You know, it's an interesting one, that, isn't it? You do get some interesting lessons in life.
Bloody oath.
And you know, it's either going to work out or not work out, depending on the choices you make. And you can make some dumb decisions, and one hopes that you know, you sort of gain a bit of wisdom from it all. That's what it's really all about. So I suppose, in summary, you'd be saying, well, what's life all about? Getting stuck into it, really, isn't it?
Yeah.
There it is. Just bite off more than you chew and chew like hell.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, you don't get second... Well, sometimes you get second chances in things you do, but you don't get second chance in life. And it might sound really cheesy, but it's true. And you've...
So 2005, Bathurst.
It's gone.
Not a replay.
It's gone.
Can't replay it. Not on a video. We're going to 2006 and we're going to get it right. that's the way you think, isn't it?
Yeah, but that race is, you know, you get the fans come up and go, oh, you know, three in a row and do this and do that. Every time I get there, every time I go to Bathurst, I don't think I can win it, right? I go arrive up there and go, I can't win it because it's just too hard. And that's my beginning every year.
So do you take it lap by lap, corner by corner, stuff like that, and it comes together? How do you do it?
Yeah. Maybe not corner by corner so much. Sometimes you do. Like when you're in a battle, you do. Or when you've 2 laps from the end and you're leaving the bloody thing, or 10 laps from the end and you're leaving it, and then you take it every 2 feet.
Absolutely.
You know, with you. Yeah. But there's times during a race when you, especially that race, when you're trying to... you know, make up some time, or you're focused on something that you need to do. You don't, you know, things sort of happen a little bit more, just naturally, right?
Yes.
But then there are times when, you know, when, you know, on the week at Bathurst when I was chasing Scafey and I was, and he had a little bit on me, you know, he was just a little tiny bit. There's some areas where I was making up some time, and there's areas where he was getting away, but, and you're really focused on every bit, like breaking into Griffin's bend, right, I'm gonna go in there, just, I'm gonna catch him. When I come out the other side, I'm gonna be closer, you know? Mm. And then you're focused. But then there's other times when you're just trying to maintain a pace, I suppose, where it's not so critical. And then at the end, as I say, if you're winning the thing, well, geez, you're riding it the whole way. Because at that stage, you're going, this can't be happening. You know, this can't be happening. And that's what it is to me. That's what that race
is
to me.
It's a euphoric feeling, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, but it's... I think, I don't know, people try to say, oh, so what's the difference? You know, why do you go so good at Bathurst? You know, what's the thing about it? Well, I think it's... It stems so far back to being young and sitting there and watching on TV and just this dream of being able to even just race cars and stuff and just that race, this part of the world. It's the mecca of it. I hope that it never loses any of its legend status at all, because we can't ever forget it, of what it's meant to car racing in this part of the world. And you know, New Zealand is no different in the way it respects, obviously.
I mean, you and I both spend a fair bit of time there, and we both enjoy a, you know, quite a
bloody oath
recognition factor there, and it's staggering, isn't it?
Staggering. And the growth there of the popularity of the sport is even more than what it is here. I mean, it's just ridiculous. So, you know, that's what I feel about the place, and it's... And so when you are leading it, or you're going to win the thing, it's hard to believe, because... You know, this is bloody Bathurst.
I'm here. I'm Greg Murphy from Hawke's Bay.
And I've won what?
I'm doing what?
Yeah.
Okay, Murph. Thanks for Kappa.
Thanks, buddy.
Always a pleasure, Pete. Thanks very much for coming along.
Questions, okay?
Yeah, they're fine.
We'll edit them out, mate, if they're cool. We'll do the
If they were no good, I'd be kicking you out right now.
Murph, very pleasant little leafy suburb. I just think that you're totally out of character here, to be honest with you.
Well, you know, it's interim, Pete. It's interim, you know. I don't want everyone to get the wrong idea about, you know, Murph and what his tastes are like. You know, it's okay. It's suiting us at the moment. It's, you know.
It's new one, what? Will it be sharper or what? A bit more chrome and
glass? We're working on the plans.
Couple of new Commodores here in the... driveway.
You'd be disappointed if that was something else, wouldn't you?
I'd be shocked.
Yeah.
Little HSV job here.
Yeah, that'll do. Do nicely.
How the hell did you get this HSV
job? Actually,
that car
is the prize of the next Super Cheap giveaway. That car is being given away to a lucky Super Cheap customer.
As driven by
that
Greg
car,
Murphy.
Probably stay that dirty as well.
And also, has it got new brake pads coming its way? Or
listen, that car is probably the most sedately driven HSV in the world, that one.
Why, because you carry your kids in the car, man?
No, because I'm just behind, and when I'm driving around here, I'm as boring as all hell, but...
Some
Yeah, what, you can't not be.
No, can't that's not a, be. That's a, that's a, what about this little blue job?
That's not mine. Someone just parked it there, I thought it was yours.
No, it wasn't mine, actually. Yeah. I was looking at it, thinking it looked all right.
All right, bugger off.
See you, buddy.
See ya.
Okay, so... Cameraman's got his act back together again now, thank goodness.
Yeah,
it's hard to get good help in it, mate.
Well, I like using the terminology, you know, it's hard to soar like an eagle when you're surrounded by turkeys.
And, of course, you've always spoken your mind. There is a classic example of Greg Murphy getting out there and not worrying about any political correctness, because now that guy with the camera is probably going to pull some shots on you to make
you look
bad.
Yeah, he may look really terrible.
Yeah.
He
will do it.
It's for sure.
But you saw you live by the sword, don't you? That's your caper.
That's right. That's right, yeah. You have to. I mean, you have to.
Well, you know what? Actually, it was a pain in the ass because you were retiring.
I know.
And you drove me mad. Was the Cameron's phone? I thought you said he turned that off.
Oh, I don't
know. He's a liar.
What happened to you pick up cheap help like that? They need to have their mobile phone in case a job offer comes along.
Maybe the fans should write in just to say what they reckon the quality of this film's like.
Exactly.